menyusun misi, yaitu pertama, menyelenggarakan pendidikan dan pembelajaran secara profesional dan kompetitif di bidang kesehatan, kemaritiman, dan kelautan yang berbasis perkembangan iptek kesehatan. Kedua, menyelenggarakan penelitian dan publikasi ilmiah secara profesional dan kompetitif di bidang kesehatan, kemaritiman, dan kelautan yang berbasis perkembangan iptek kesehatan. Ketiga, menyelenggarakan pengabdian kepada masyarakat secara profesional dan kompetitif di bidang kesehatan, kemaritiman, dan kelautan yang berbasis perkembangan iptek kesehatan. Keempat, menyelenggarakan tata kelola kelembagaan secara profesional dan kompetitif di bidang kesehatan, kemaritiman, dan kelautan yang berbasis perkembangan iptek kesehatan.
Kami menerapkan tata nilai di lingkungan Stikes Hangtua Surabaya yang mendasari sikap dan perilaku seluruh sivitas akademika. Tata nilai yang kami laksanakan adalah cerdas. Cerdas merupakan singkatan dari nilai-nilai luhur yang kami yakini, yaitu caring, excellent, respectful, disiplin, altruistik, dan smart.
Stikes Hangtua Surabaya telah memiliki 5 program studi, yaitu D3 Keperawatan, S1 Keperawatan, Prodi Pendidikan Profesi Nurse, S1 Gizi, dan D4 Manajemen Informasi Kesehatan. Program studi keperawatan adalah program studi unggulan di Stikes Hangtua Surabaya. Kami selalu mencetak tenaga keperawatan medis yang unggul dan siap bersaing di dunia kerja. Prodi ini dibagi menjadi 2, yaitu Prodi Keperawatan S1 dan D3. Alumni Diploma 3 Keperawatan berperan sebagai perawat terampil dalam menyelesaikan masalah keperawatan secara mandiri dan berkelompok yang direncanakan sesuai dengan standar asuhan keperawatan, dengan kemampuan menerima tanggung jawab terhadap keputusan dan tindakan asuhan keperawatan profesional sesuai dengan lingkup praktik dan hukum dan peraturan perundangan. Prodi S1 Ilmu Keperawatan menyelenggarakan pendidikan akademik untuk menghasilkan sarjana keperawatan dengan gelar S.Kep yang nantinya berpeluang untuk melanjutkan pendidikan ke jenjang profesi nurse ataupun jenjang magister sesuai dengan minat masing-masing. Prodi Pendidikan Profesi Nurse merupakan perawat profesional yang cerdas dan kompeten dalam memberikan asuhan keperawatan kepada klien dan mampu melakukan fungsi manajemen keperawatan. Prodi S1 Gizi mencetak lulusan yang dapat menjadi pengambil keputusan dalam memecahkan permasalahan gizi, baik program dan kebijakan gizi, komunitas maupun sosial secara profesional dan bertanggung jawab. Prodi D4 Manajemen Informasi Kesehatan mencetak lulusan yang kompeten dalam mengumpulkan, mengintegrasikan, dan menganalisa data rekam medis serta data pendukung lainnya untuk kepentingan perawatan pasien yang efektif serta kepentingan lain seperti penelitian, pendidikan, perencanaan, dan evaluasi pelayanan kesehatan. Sarana pembelajaran yang lengkap sangat diperlukan untuk menunjang efektivitas pembelajaran offline guna meningkatkan kompetensi mahasiswa. Sarana yang terdapat di Stikes Hangtua Surabaya adalah lab keperawatan dasar, keperawatan medikal bedah dan gawat darurat, lab keperawatan maternitas dan anak, lab jiwa, komunitas dan keluarga, jiwa dan gerontik, laboratorium biomedik, anatomi dan ruang tutorial, lab skill yang terdiri dari 2 lantai untuk meningkatkan skill prosedur, lab komputer, perpustakaan terdiri dari ruang baca, ruang internet, dan ruang pelayanan. C. Selain itu, untuk mendukung pembelajaran daring, tersedia berbagai macam video pembelajaran di website dan YouTube. Indonesia, sebagai negara maritim terbesar dunia, memiliki sejumlah wilayah laut, pesisir, dan pulau-pulau kecil yang luas dan bermakna strategis dalam pembangunan ekonomi nasional. Stikes Hang Tuah Surabaya, dalam peranannya di bidang pendidikan kesehatan, memberikan wawasan kesehatan maritim dan kelautan di dalam kurikulum pendidikannya, dalam bentuk materi kuliah matra kesehatan, laut, dan udara, serta dibentuknya UKM atau Unit Kegiatan Mahasiswa Kesmala. Stikes Hang Tuah Surabaya telah bekerja sama dengan instansi untuk penyerapan lulusan, yakni RSPAL Dr. Ramelan Surabaya, Rumah Sakit Mitra Keluarga Group, National Hospital Surabaya, Siloam International Hospitals. Selain itu, kami juga bekerja sama dengan beberapa instansi untuk lahan praktik mahasiswa Stikes Hang Tuah Surabaya, yakni RSPAL Dr. Ramelan Surabaya, RSAL Dr. Sukantio Jahya Lanudal Juanda, RS Marinir Ewa Pangalila Gunung Sari Surabaya, Lembaga Kesehatan Kelautan TNI AL, Diskes Kuarmada 2, Rumah Sakit Haji Surabaya, Rumah Sakit PHC Surabaya, Rumah Sakit Jiwa Menur Surabaya, UPTD Gria Werda Jambangan Surabaya, Diponsos Keputih Surabaya, Dinas Kesehatan Kota Surabaya, Puskesmas di Kota Surabaya. Tingkat kelulusan mahasiswa Stikes Hang Tuah Surabaya. Tingkat kelulusan ujian kompetensi D3 keperawatan 96,8% Oktober 2020. Tingkat kelulusan ujian kompetensi profesi nurse 94,7% Oktober 2020. Tingkat penyerapan lulusan yang bekerja sebagai tenaga kesehatan di fasilitas pelayanan kesehatan lebih dari 90%. Tingkat masa tunggu kerja kurang dari 6 bulan lebih dari 90%. Hal ini menandakan bahwa lulusan Stikes Hang Tuah Surabaya siap untuk masuk ke dunia kerja.
Salam tangguh, salam sehat, salam kemanusiaan. COVID-19 di Indonesia telah ditetapkan sebagai bencana nasional tepatnya pada tanggal 2 Maret 2020. Pandemi ini berdampak pada semua aspek kehidupan, baik di sektor kesehatan, sektor ekonomi, sektor sosial, dan kemasyarakatan, tanpa kecuali di sektor pendidikan. Kendati demikian, adanya pandemi ini mampu mengakselerasi pendidikan di era revolusi industri 4.0. Wabah corona ini justru memacu dunia pendidikan dengan mendorong lebih banyak pemanfaatan teknologi informasi dalam aktivitas belajar jarak jauh. Namun pada kondisi ini, terdapat tantangan yang besar dalam pelaksanaannya. Menjawab tantangan tersebut, Stikes Hang Tuah Surabaya dengan membentuk Satgas COVID-19 dan mempersiapkan sarana-prasarana yang sesuai sebagai adaptasi kebiasaan baru dalam kehidupan kampus. Stikes Hang Tuah Surabaya siap menjadi kampus tangguh, yaitu kampus yang menyelenggarakan Tridharma Perguruan Tinggi dengan memprioritaskan kesehatan dan keselamatan bagi seluruh peserta didik, pendidik, tenaga kependidikan, keluarga, dan masyarakat. Saya dibantu oleh seluruh Civitas Akademika di bawah koordinasi bidang 1, 2, dan 3 terus mengembangkan diri menjawab tantangan ini. Di bidang 1, bidang akademik, kurikulum dan model pembelajaran disiapkan untuk menjawab era industri 4.0 dengan memastikan ketersediaan sarana dan prasarana serta sistem informasi yang memadai, memastikan kegiatan pembelajaran baik di kelas, laboratorium maupun klinik dapat terlaksana secara blended learning dengan memprioritaskan keamanan, kesehatan, dan keselamatan. Di bidang 2, menjamin seluruh kegiatan administrasi umum dan kepegawaian berjalan dengan baik serta menyediakan sarana-prasarana yang mendukung upaya protokol kesehatan yang memadai. Di bidang 3, kemahasiswaan, berbagai penyesuaian dilaksanakan untuk memastikan kegiatan kemahasiswaan baik intra maupun ekstra kurikuler dapat terus berjalan dengan memanfaatkan teknologi informasi. Pada masa pandemik ini, STIKES Hang Tuah Surabaya telah mempersiapkan diri dengan baik, menerapkan protokol kesehatan untuk mencegah COVID-19 di lingkungan kampus, kami laksanakan dengan disiplin tinggi. STIKES Hang Tuah Surabaya berkomitmen sebagai kampus tangguh.
STIKES Hang Tuah Surabaya adalah institusi pendidikan di bawah TNI Angkatan Laut yang mahasiswanya belajar di wahana rumah sakit militer, yaitu Rumah Sakit Pusat Angkatan Laut Dr. Ramlan Surabaya. Mereka mendapat pendidikan yang penuh disiplin dan bertanggung jawab, menjadikan mereka sebagai mahasiswa yang unggul. Ini mempermudah kami untuk transfer pengetahuan dan attitude kepada mereka. Oleh sebab itu, hampir sebagian besar lulusan STIKES Hang Tuah Surabaya setelah lulus dari pendidikan dapat diterima di Rumah Sakit Pusat Angkatan Laut Dr. Ramlan Surabaya, juga di rumah sakit-rumah sakit di Surabaya dan sekitarnya. Semoga STIKES Hang Tuah Surabaya selalu jaya dan senantiasa memberikan kontribusi terbaik bagi nusa dan bangsa.
Wawasan kelautan yang saya dapat dari STIKES Hang Tuah Surabaya mampu meningkatkan profesionalisme saya sebagai tenaga kesehatan di lingkungan TNI Angkatan Laut.
Saya Sivira Kristiningrum, Eskepnes, perawat senior ICU Sentral RSPAL Dr. Ramlan Surabaya. STIKES Hang Tuah Surabaya telah mengantarkan saya menjadi perawat profesional.
Nama saya Nurs Imam Muhaji, Eskep MHGES. Saya alumni STIKES Hang Tuah Surabaya yang telah mengantarkan saya menjadi aparatur sipil negara atau PNS di Dinas Kesehatan Kota Surabaya.
STIKES Hang Tuah Surabaya itu cerdas. Saya Niputu Gita Wirani, asal Tabanan, Bali. STIKES Hang Tuah Surabaya itu caring.
Saya Carlo Milando Lesander Joasan, asal Manado, Sulawesi Utara. STIKES Hang Tuah Surabaya itu excellent.
Saya Salva Mbena Putri dari Solo, Jawa Tengah. STIKES Hang Tuah Surabaya itu respectful.
Saya Feli Alexander Mbate dari Kupang, NTT. STIKES Hang Tuah Surabaya itu discipline.
Saya Demeniku Sukma Adi Prasetyo dari Katingan, Kalimantan Tengah. STIKES Hang Tuah Surabaya itu altruistik.
Saya Muhammad Fadel dari Bima Nusa Tenggara Barat. STIKES Hang Tuah Surabaya itu smart.
Lebih dari 20 tahun, kami berproses dalam membentuk sebuah lembaga pendidikan kesehatan untuk mencapai sasaran terwujudnya masyarakat yang makin sejahtera, lahir dan batin, secara adil dan merata. Terselenggaranya pendidikan nasional dan pelayanan kesehatan yang makin bermutu serta merata mewujudkan manusia berbudi pekerti luhur, tangguh, sehat, cerdas, patriotik, berdisiplin, kreatif, produktif, dan profesional. kami akan terus berkembang dan akan meraih mimpi kami, yaitu menjadi sekolah tinggi ilmu kesehatan yang mandiri, bermartabat, kompetitif, dan berwawasan kesehatan maritim dan kelautan pada tahun 2031.
Mari bergabung bersama kami.
Stikes Hang Tuah Surabaya. Jaya!
Good morning, Achan.
Good morning.
Yes, we can start now, right?
Yes, yes, yeah. Shall we start now?
All right.
Yes, I think we are ready to start.
Yeah, please a minute.
Okay. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Waalaikumsalam warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Waalaikumsalam warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. The Honorable Dr. Alfisri Suhardiningsih, Sarjana Keperawatan Magister Kesehatan, the Director of Stikes Hang Tuah Surabaya. The Honorable Dr. Nisakon Fibulcai, the Director of Sri Mahasarakan Nursing College Thailand. The distinguished speaker Dr. Supia Firifai and Mrs. Hidayatus Sa'dia, Sarjana Keperawatan Nurse Magister Kesehatan. The Excellency Vice Director Sri Mahasarakam Nursing College and Stikes Hang Tuah Surabaya. Lecturer from Sri Mahasarakam Nursing College and Stikes Hang Tuah Surabaya. The Distinguished Committee Academic Exchange and dear all the students and participants. First of all, let us pray and praise to Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala, God Almighty, because of His blessed and mercy, we can join in the event Virtual Academic Exchange, guest lecture among Stikes Hang Tuah Surabaya and Sri Mahasarakam Nursing College, Thailand, 2022. Praise and salutation upon our Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, who had brought us to the part of light from the darkness in his life. Ladies and gentlemen, here's the tentative for this event today as follows. Opening, singing Indonesian and Thailand anthem. The greeting message from the director of Sri Mahasarakam Nursing College Thailand. Guest lecture session 1, Dr. Supia Wirifai, giving certificate appreciation by Director of Stikes Hang Tuah Surabaya. Guest lecture session 2, Mrs. Hidayatus Sa'dia, giving certificate appreciated by Director of Sri Mahasarakam Nursing College Thailand. Photo session and closing. Ladies and gentlemen, let's open this event by saying basmalah. Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Thank you. As the first agenda of today's event, let's stand together to singing Indonesian anthem.
Oh, no.
Thank you. Okay, firstly, we invite Dr. Nisakorn Fibulchai to deliver a greeting speech for this event. Good morning, Dr. Nisakorn. Okay, please, time is yours.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Dr. Are C. Suharding Linse, Head of STIKES Hang Tua Surabaya, and distinguished delegate for today. Thank you all of you for being here today regarding our commitment to organizing the exchange program. The first student exchange program was done on December 9, 2020. And in that time, it was highly appreciated for successful collaboration on the digital platform due to COVID-19 pandemics. Today is a second time for the exchange. The exchange is lecturer academic exchange. As we know, COVID-19 situation has been not allowing, so we still move up the exchange in form of online. In this time, I would like to convey my heartfelt gratitude to two guest speakers for today. The first one is Haida Yatus Yadiya from STIKES Hang Tua Surabaya for accepting the invitation for being guest speaker for her presentation on the topic caregiver empowerment for elderly with dementia. And the second one is Dr. Supiya Wilifai from Simhasarakam Nursing College, Thailand, for her presentation today is simulation-based learning, just like the real things. So the topics for today are so interesting. I hope everyone successful and fruitful for joining with this webinar today. Lastly, if the COVID-19 situation is allowing, I hope Dr. Awe, faculty, students from STIKES Hang Tua Surabaya have an opportunity to visit here, and we have to give warm welcome to all of you. And also, we would like to visit STIKES Hang Tua Surabaya as usual. Thank you very much. Enjoy with this exchange.
Thank you.
Yeah, thank you, Dr. Nisakorn. Okay, the next agenda is main lecturer. Now we invite Mr. Natawood as a moderator to lead the guest lecture session one. Mr. Natawood?
Yes, I am here.
Okay, good morning.
Okay, thank you so much, and good morning, everyone, from Indonesia and Thailand as well. Today, I'm really appreciative that we have this event, and as you have taken your time off to joining us, I hope we will learn a lot from this event. Okay, from the next, I would like to show our last memory as we have done together between Indonesia and Thailand. Okay, let's see together.
Okay, Mr. Natawood, maybe your time is around 1 hour.
Yes.
Okay, time is yours.
This is I will be showing our video from the last we have done together, yes, about 3 minutes.
Okay.
Have you seen our screen?
Yeah.
I always knew this day would come. We'd be standing one by one with our future in our hands. So many dreams, so many plans. I always knew after all these years there'd be laughter, there'd be tears. But never thought I'd walk away with so much joy but so much pain. And it's so hard.
Thank you so much. Maybe we can give applause for that video. Okay.
Okay, thank you so much. Thank you so much.
Maybe after this pandemic, maybe we can visit Sri Masyarakat Nursing College. And Mr. Natawood?
Yes.
Your time is around 1 hour. Time is
yes. All right, from the next sessions, I would like to introduce for our guest speaker from Sri Mahasarakham Nursing College. She is a graduate from Flinders University from Australia. She is a head of maternal and child health nursing faculty in Sri Mahasarakham Nursing College, faculty of nursing, Pabalom Rasanok Institute. Okay, she is a Dr. Supriya Vilify. She will ask about in the topic simulation based learning, just like a real things. Please, Dr. Supriya, please give a big hand for her, please. Please, Dr. Supriya.
Thank you, Ajahn Natwood. Good morning, everyone. I'm glad to be here to share with you about learning activity regarding simulation. Today, I'm going to present about in four section. Oh, sorry, the slide is not moved on. Sorry. Okay, we have some problem with the technique. Sorry about that. Sorry, it's too slow. Okay, move to the next slide. Today I'm going to present about four sections. The first section is about why our college use simulation. The next section is about why is simulation like real things and the benefits of simulation. In the last section, I'm going to show you about how to integrate simulation in nursing and midwifery curriculum. Let me start with why we use simulation. According to Thai Qualification Framework for Higher Education, or TQF, this standard requires six characteristics of nursing science graduate. So the instructor have to follow this standard. Six characteristics, including moral and ethics, knowledge, cognitive skill, interpersonal skill, numerical analysis, technology skill, and professional skill. Also, we have some problem with teaching practice. The instructor still focus on content rather than analytical thinking, which doesn't encourage students to apply theory. Which doesn't encourage students to apply theoretical knowledge in nursing practice. Moreover, during the COVID pandemic, the student limited on training during at that time, this may have impact the opportunity to learn basic clinical and professional skill. Why simulation is like a real thing? Because simulation is activity that mimics the reality of a clinical environment and decide to demonstrate procedure, decision-making, critical thinking through the technique such as interactive video or manicure. We have three simulation about sim mom, sim man, and sim junior. We acknowledge simulation is useful for academic activity and student developing. You know, simulation is turn knowledge into the practice. And develop many skills of the student, such as problem solving skill, technical skill, attitude, reflection skill, and leadership. Student can do simulation many times and correct their mistake without harmful the patient. This is the advantage of the simulation. Move to the next slide. I'm going to show you about how to integrate simulation into nursing and midwifery curriculum. There are three processes about how to integrate. The first one is planning. The second process is implementation. The last one is evaluation. Let's see the planning simulation. The first step is building the scenario. In my faculty, the instructor, first of all, they have to identify the education requirement following the TQF and identify the subject and student level. After we identify, we select four subjects to integrate simulation. For example, we apply to maternal and child health nursing theory and maternal and child health nursing practicum. After they select everything, the instructor have to set out the objective related to the simulation. The next step, the instructor have to prepare environment. You can see the photo on the slide. You can see the instructor and the technician prepare and check the sim mount before start the simulation and check equipment in the room to prepare before we let's start. This slide going to show about the number of subjects we apply simulation into. We have four subjects. Two of them is theory, and the others is practicum. After we select the subject, and we have to build the scenario related to the subject. We have a normal delivery case, premature rupture of membrane case, ecampsia and prolapse case. In my faculty, the instructor helped to create this scenario and recheck again before we start the scenario. This slide, I'm going to show about the sample of case scenario about normal delivery. The component of a case scenario, including the scenario overview. This is about the overview of case and the main objective. The next bullet is about the scenario objective. This is a specific objective to the aim to know about the outcome of the student. The next bullet is about the past unit and present unit of the patient. It shows and give the student before to start the scenario. The next page is about the question. This question we use before start a scenario and after finish the scenario to reflect the student. Okay, you can see the room about the, you can see the room and the control room next to the simulation room. Before we let's start, we have to prepare everything, prepare the simulator, equipment, and material. Okay. Next step is implementation. There are three processes. The first process is pre-briefing. The second process is action. And the last process is debriefing. I'm going to show about What is pre-briefing? This technique we take time about 20 minutes. The instructor have to give information about the scenario, the information of the patient. I mean, the patient is the simulator and equipment in the room. And the instructor have to reduce anxiety, the student. When the instructor see the face of student, sometimes they feel the face look anxious about what happened in the room. And the instructor have to reduce that thing. The next step, move to the action. The action take time about 25 to 30 minutes, depend on the cases. And the instructor divide the student into group. The first group participate in the scenario as nurse. The others participate in the scenario as the observer. The observer observe on all present activities such as teamwork, communication, and nursing practice in that room. You can see that room, the prayer inside the room, and they have to pray, follow the scenario. The student sit outside the room is observer. And they have to observe all activity inside the room and jot note on their paper and reflect them. The next slide, I'm going to show you about the overview of the room. We have the camera, and this camera can record the situation in this room. After that, the instructor can check the procedure and reflect the all procedure in that room. Next to the simulation room is control room. Some instructor participate in that room as a nurse, as a doctor, as a patient. Some of them control the simulator via the computer. You can see the screen. Some of the instructor control the symptom of the simulator by using the computer, such as increase the Phaeton heart sound, increase or decrease the blood pressure. Okay, move to the last step is debriefing. Debriefing take time about 30 minutes to 1 hour. The instructor have to give opportunity to students to share their experience about what happened in the room and reflect their activity. The role of the instructor is create the meaning out of their experience and reflect of the action and transfer learning to situation. Okay, I'm going to show you about the video. How we apply the simulation and what happened next in the action of step. Hang on, there's some problem again. It stuck it a little bit. Oh my God. This is no sound because it's noisy inside the room. I'm going to let you know about what happened in the room. First of all, the instructor give information to the student about the scenario. This is a pre-briefing section. And the student follow the scenario. Now they ask their friend to become in charge leader and member. And then let's start the scenario. Okay, you see? Sorry, it's Thai version. I can translate to you. And first of all, student asks the patient about what happened, what the symptom right now, and what you feel right now, and check the and oh, sorry about that, and assess the patient physical. Right now, the instructor acts as a facilitator, not involve the situation. You can see, I can pass forward. Okay, after that, the symptom of the patient progress. The student have to practice follow the symptom of the patient until they have the patient giving birth. The student have to prepare equipment. Okay, you can see it's not right right now, and the instructor have to jot down something and give the score to them, and okay, it's too fast because the head is coming out right now. The student has to make decision. How should they do? You have to, if you act as the instructor, you have to look at them and reflect them about that. Okay, the head is coming out right now. Sorry, it's no sound. Just only my voice. It leave head free like this. Okay. Mm-hmm. Okay, she pulling out the baby right now. Sorry, we don't have the sound. Okay, this is just only example. Okay, she clean the baby. Okay. 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 Okay, this just only example about what happened in the simulation room. You can see the instructor act as like a facilitator, and student act as a nurse team and practice with the student. Oh, sorry, with the patient. Sorry. Okay. After finish the simulation, we move to the another process. The final process is evaluation. The instructor have to assess about learning outcome following the six characteristic of TQF and the limitation of each section of scenario. I give you an example about that. For the learning outcome, we found that the student comments on evaluation form are overwhelmingly positive because the student showed that they improve their ability to apply theoretical knowledge to patient care, and they can develop six TQF domains and develop self-regulation and evaluation. Also, they think it's important thing is work with teamwork, and they can communication with their team without the instructor control. in addition, the student increase their confidence. However, we have limitation. Oh, sorry about that. It's not move. Again, we have some problem. Okay, sorry about the slide is not show on the screen. For the limitation, we found that we lack of the technician who can deal with the simulator and maintain them. And the two are not as the diverse as a human. And then it does more simulate the real situation. In addition, it's not incomplete physiological symptom such as contraction of uterus. The sound of fetal heart sound, it looks like a real sound. It's just example. This is my presentation. Do you have any question? Don't hesitate to ask the question. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Dr. Supriya, for giving us and showing about simulation-based learnings. Is this easy? Is that like a real thing as you see in that PowerPoint? Would you have any questions about her presentations? You can ask her, please.
Excuse me.
Yes, please. I can see you on the screen.
Good morning. Hello, good morning.
Yeah.
Dr. Supriya, yes. It's an amazing sharing related with the simulation laboratorium for student learning. That's we appreciate, and also we need to learn a lot about it. So far in Surabaya, we still ongoing to develop a kind of a laboratorium, integrated laboratorium. So that's a very, very amazing and useful for us to advance and expand our development. Thank you for the sharing, Dr. Supriya. Secondly, I was wondering that in the best practice situation, how to manage or evaluate the student capability if they are already competent or not related with their target for the curriculum. So how to evaluate and to manage about it. Thank you.
Sorry about this. Okay. About the evaluation. We apply the simulation in both theory and practicum. In the theory, we provide the scenario is similar in the real thing in the hospital, and we create the the form and checklist about what happened in the simulation relate to the real thing and check is and it relate with the six domain of TQF as well. And this simulation help to prepare the student before before the student go to the hospital. Maybe it makes sense to you?
Yes.
Okay.
Okay. Thank you.
Yeah. Any question? Wait a minute, please. not question, just sharing is okay for me.
Excuse me,
I can read from the chat box, maybe. Ajahn Supiya.
Yeah.
Related with the role of the instructor. Yeah. I mean that how to guide the participant or the student when they are in laboratory. Is there any kind of a standard operation or guideline to guide them during the simulation?
Oh, first of all, we have to, the student have to attend in the class first about the for example, about the process of delivery. And then the instructor have to guide the learning activity about simulation to student before start the simulation, about the process, about how to do in the simulation room. But students have to learn about themselves to take care of the patient. About and help them to giving birth, yeah, something like that. Yeah. We teach about the process, and before start the simulation, we prepare the section about pre-brief, and ask the knowledge of the student about you know about delivery, what you know, and how they help the patient to giving birth. And the nursing care of the patient is including blah, 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 something like that before they start. Mm-hmm. And after that, the instructor describe about how to get in the simulation room and take the student survey around the simulation room, make them feel comfortable before they start. Yeah. This is the preparing. It called pre-brief.
All right. Yeah. Okay. That's a good sharing. I think we can try to apply in Surabaya. Thank you, Dr. Supiya.
Okay, maybe I have one question for Dr. Supiya.
Yes, please.
Okay. How to manage and prevent infection of COVID 19 in your
laboratory? Okay.
Yeah.
I separate the student in each group about age a student in each group and separate student, divide student into two group and put masks on the times when they attend the class. Yeah. And when they get into the school, they have to check ATK first before they have a class in the school. Yeah. It's quite strict.
Well, how much students in one group?
About 8 to 10 students in each group. Yeah.
Okay.
For students in student level 4, yeah.
Four until 5.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's just not too many because we're afraid of COVID-19 as well.
Mm-hmm. So inspiring us. Okay, maybe.
Okay.
Thank you.
I another question in the chat box, Dr. Supia, related with the you know the scenario. The scenario that the student for the student before they enter the laboratorium. So do you think that the scenario try to design to get the critical thinking of the student, and then the team of the student will try to have a problem solving first, then try to do the action what's supposed to do from their skill, yeah, or maybe there is a kind of a, you know, time to their to arrange first, and then will be forward to the another action. I mean the practice. How about the scenario? I mean that the quality and the deep of the content. Thank you.
We developed the scenario by using the team. Thank you, the team. The team is sit next to me. You see, my smiling with them. We create the scenario and checked by our team who have more and more experience about the case. We select the scenario suitable with the student level. I mean, the student level 3, we have to select the scenario about normal delivery, just only normal delivery. It's not complicated. But for student level 4, we have to choose the scenario with the severe patient, such as ischemia, and we discuss about the scenario many times and make a fit and not too long and choose the key point to create the critical thinking of the student, such as when the patient have a seizure during they have pre-ischemia and how the student do. We discuss this point many times. Yeah. And after that, we have the the expert to check my our scenario before we start. I think it's quite deep scenario to improve the critical thinking of the student. Yes, this is answered your question. Okay. We use the team in my faculty and the expert to help to create the scenario.
Yeah, to analyze that and to decide that this is a compatible or equal with the competencies of the student, right?
Yes.
Yeah. Thank you very much for the sharing.
Thank you. Any question? No. Okay. Okay,
maybe any question?
Yeah, any question? Okay, if you don't have a question.
Okay, excuse me, Dr. Sophia, yeah. Have a question. Can you hear me?
Okay, if you don't have the question, thank you so much for attending.
One question, again. One question again, excuse me. Professor.
Hello, good morning.
From Mrs. Hidayatus.
Okay. Sorry?
Can you hear me? Dr. Supia?
I can hear you.
Okay.
Okay, thank you so much.
Okay, I want to ask about how to... What is it? The laboratory set the necessary tools according to the material, because we have many material that can give to the student, how we can set a laboratory for simulation. How about this? To manage the instrument.
Okay. We have many labs of simulation. The show for today about just only SimMum. Before we start laboratory, we have to check all equipment. For example, we have to check about the SimMum. The SimMum is important because SimMum can show everything about the patient. The instructor and the technician from the company who belong to the simulator have to check, and then the instructor add the scenario in the computer, and they try many time because let's start about the simulation. Because sometimes it's not fit. We change a lot before we let's start. And we have the lab boy to prepare our equipment that's similar with the clinical setting. Yes. And we check everything. And if it's not enough or it's not sufficiency, we ask the hospital to help sometimes we ask some instrument from the hospital to put inside the simulation room. Yes, this is the preparing of the laboratory. Yes.
Okay, thank you. Thank you, Dr. Supiya.
Any question?
Okay, we see Miss Christina Julia Stuti present.
Yeah, thank you, Dr. Supiya. My name is Christina. Thank you for your great presentation. Actually, my first question is same with Mrs. Stuti question about how to evaluate the role of each student, because student ability are different. But I think you have already answered that. Continuing from the Mrs. Stuti question, we know that sometimes some students are passive when they have to work in a team. I would like to know, how do you handle this? And my third question is, how many times do students have to do self-study before they take a simulation-based learning? Thank you.
It's too many to get involved in simulation, because we have many students per class. We have to divide the student in each group, about 8 students in each group. And we have to take time to put the student in the simulation room. Yes, it's quite hard to do that. The number of time is about the theory, 1 or 2 times student get involved in the simulation. And sometimes we have to check this. The next question you asked about how to handle when the student communication with teamwork. Sometimes they not communicate with the teamwork, but we use the reflection after they finish the simulation and ask about what happened inside the room, how to deal with problem, how to communicate with the teamwork. It's not good. How to improve? We have used the reflection to help them to improve themselves. In the next time, we use our instructor to follow this student, yeah, and check the student again they improve or not. If they not improve, we have to reflect and again and again. Yeah. Okay. This is our step or our process in my nursing college.
So the reflection is in the third session, debrief session.
The debrief section, because debrief section is most important in the simulation, because reflection helps students to improve themselves about their ability, about their critical thinking. When the student get inside the room, they don't think anything, just follow the scenario. After that, they reflect what happened inside that and what they do, and is it right or wrong, or is it okay for them? I think I need a debrief more than procedure, because debrief, the student can look at what happened about themselves, what happened they can do or not. Yeah. Okay, answer the question.
Yes, thank you.
Okay. Any question?
Okay, thank you. Question, Sophia. Is it any question? Everyone, I think it's enough. Thank you, Dr. Supia. We verify that amazing sharing, so inspiring us to keep our students feel good with simulation case and practice. And thank you to Mr. Natawood as moderator. Okay. Okay, Mr. Natawood, maybe you have any comment or conclusion?
Yes, thank you, Dr. Sibaya, really fine. Yes, and showing and sharing us about simulation-based learnings. And we have a lot of questions, and that is beautiful presentations. Thank you so much again. Okay, I think that is finished our session from presentations. For the next session, we would like to move on that Stai Hang to Surabaya presentation, please.
Okay, thank you. Give applause for Dr. Supia Wirifai and Mr. Natawood. Okay, the next session is giving certificate appreciation. The director of Stikes Hang Tuah Surabaya will deliver the digital certificate to Dr. Supia Wirifai. We invite Dr. Afe to give the certificate, please.
Thank you, Dr. Supia Wirifai. Your presentation is very, very interesting for me. Thank you.
Okay, thank you.
Good morning. Sawadika. Firstly, I would like to thank you to the speaker, Dr. Supia Wirifai and Madam Hidayatu Sadia, Sarjana Keperawatan, Magister Kesehatan, and all the community and the participants who join today in this forum academic exchange, guest lecture and student exchange among Sri Mahasarakam Nursing College in Thailand and Sekolah Tinggi Ilmu Kesehatan Stikes Hang Tuah Surabaya, Indonesia, even though with virtual meeting. I believe the event positively upgrade the quality of knowledge and network among us, furthermore, more work need to be done due to new challenges in the era new normal of pandemic COVID-19 in years ahead. Finally, I would like to express my gratitude, the highest appreciation to the director of Sri Mahasarakam Nursing College, Thailand, Dr. Nisakom Vibulai, who have made this student academic exchange possible. Thank you all for joining this virtual academic exchange. See you again. Kokuka. Goodbye.
Thank you, Dr. Afe, for the appreciation speech.
I am sorry. Have to attend another meeting. My apologies. Have to leave the Zoom room. Thank you.
Dr. Afe. Thank you so much for the appreciation speech. Okay, ladies and gentlemen, we're running to the next session, guest lecture session 2. We invite the moderator, Mrs. Dwi Priyantini, to lead the session around 1 hour.
All right.
Time is yours.
Thank you, Ibu Sukma. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Hello and sawadika. Welcome to the second session of the guest lecture today. My name is Dwi, will be in charge as moderator. Thank you for the MC to have a time for me around 1 hour ahead. In this session, we will hear and having discussion with our speaker, Mrs. Hidayat Usadia. She is next to me now. Related with the elderly, as we know that naturally we will be going older and we have an elderly people in our surrounding, and I'm sure we are facing many kind of break and sorrow. Today, our speaker will be focused on caregiver empowerment for elderly with dementia. Mrs. Hidayatu is a lecturer, a nursing lecturer. She is a focus on community and gerontology nursing care. And right now, she is in the final stage taking her doctoral program, PhD in Erlangga University, Surabaya. And then her publication and her books are recommended to be our reference. All right. Without further ado, please welcome. We invite our speaker, Mrs. Hidayat Usadia, ready to share the PPT, right?
Okay.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Yeah. All right. Thank you. Okay. It's nice having you here. And then maybe you can share the PPT and prepare for it.
Okay.
Your presentation will be around 20 minutes, and then we will have a discussion. And then to the audience, if there is any question, please feel the question in the chat box, Zoom or in YouTube, and there we will have discussion after the presentation. Without further ado, Ms. Hidayatus, please present your sharing and experience about it.
Okay, Mrs. Dwi, thank you. I was given an extraordinary opportunity. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Good morning. Sawadika, the Honorable of the Director of Dikes Hang Tuah Surabaya, Dr. Afe Sri Suwadiningsih, Sarjana Keperawatan Magister Kesehatan, the Director of Sri Mahasarakam Nursing College, Dr. Nisakom Fabuchai. I'm very pleased to be here in Scientific Forum Lecturer Exchange with Sri Mahasarakam Nursing College and Dikes Hang Tuah Surabaya. Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alamin, we are always blessing by Allah and in good health. And then today I'm focused on the result of our research, development of home care based on caregiver empowerment to improve the independence of dementia elderly. As we know, when we are discussed about AIDS, do you ever wonder to be going as an older in the future, or maybe we will have elderly as a patient with dementia or exercise? And then this is for the result of our research. It's about development of home care based on caregiver empowerment, improve the independence of dementia elderly. As we know that elderly with dementia increase in case in several countries, including in Asia, Indonesia, Thailand, or except Thai. There is a cure positive decline cognitive ability that need long-term care, and then decreased activity daily living, decreased verbal communication, decreased cognitive and aggressive behavior. And effort or program for elderly have not involved the family independence, and dementia is considered something reasonable for family. And then Indonesia or Asia have a tradition that the family plays an important role in treatment strategies, decision making, basic family function, family duties in the health sector. And then Indonesia plays an active role in issuing policies regarding the elderly, like national standard for elderly social rehabilitation, and then health Indonesia program family approach, national action plan for the elderly, global commitment to the World Elderly Program, and then development home care based on caregiver empowerment to increase the independence of the elderly with dementia must have to be discussed, to be researching for this. This our research purpose. There are general purpose, development home care based on caregiver empowerment to increase the independence of the elderly with dementia, and the special purpose and several factors that influence family ability to do home care, and effect of home care ability towards the independence of the elderly with dementia. We have conceptual framework for our research is several factors like elderly, family, healthcare, or health service, and caregiver demand, family values, family appraisal, influence to family ability, and influence to improve independence of the elderly with dementia. Many analyze tests to be get for our method. There are analyzing the effect of home care ability on the independence of the elderly, like PERTI test and Hotel Institute and linear regression. And then there is our result for our research. Many characteristics for family, like age, gender, job, and education until income for the family. More than 50 years, the age for the family, female for the gender, job, most of the job is housewife, education is primary school, and income including of regional minimum wage. Family ability to do home care that before and after we have or we given family training and health education about home care, how family to do home care for the elderly with dementia. There is several indicators that we can see like perceived health, perceived growth, and existential well-being. For the analyze test, that our training for home like home care improve family ability to do home care for elderly. That we value for treatment group, there are less than 0.05. There are effect or influence for training or health education that we do effect on family ability to do home care. And then independency of the elderly with dementia with indicator for verbal communication, activity daily living, cognitive ability, and aggressive behavior, we can see that treatment group like verbal communication, activity daily living, cognitive and aggressive behavior have a result that our training or our counseling or our health education for the family that family can do this for ability family to do home care that improve independence of the elderly with dementia. Okay, for the discussion, the family ability to do home care through the three aspects. Number one is perceived health, perceived good, and existential well-being. Existential well-being, or from the result, is the highest indicator that has increased after the intervention. Existential well-being, like it is due to the family carrying out explanatory activities for the elderly with dementia, such as health insurance, financial support, transport support, information support, health support, recreational, social activities, and family gathering. Family do this activity to increase existential well-being and to support elderly with dementia. It is the highest indicator that has increased after the intervention. Family age around for than 50 years. There are female gender and as a couple, even though elementary school education and income regional minimum wage. And then for the independence for the elderly, activity daily living, elderly has the highest increase after intervention. ADL or activity daily living is done every day by elderly. It is not through effort or hard work according to ability, like bathing, dressing, eating, or mobilizing. Easy for elderly to do. And then other indicators, including communication, cognitive, and aggressive behavior, is about behavior and psychological symptom of dementia. Consists of behavioral symptoms, psychological and psychotic, or personal change of the elderly, caused by neurology and neurotransmitter. It is cause reduction in neurology cell and then carry out their function, which have a clinical visible impact on behavior and psychology. This is the effect for elderly dependency. Okay, elderly independence is influenced by dementia, elderly, and then risk of falling, and then disease factor. Another factor is responsibility, self-confidence of the elderly, experience, autonomous, ability to solve problem, health need, and social support. Social support, there is from family. Family can do some ability to do home care for the elderly with dementia. It is social support or family support that can we increase, that can we develop for elderly with dementia to be, some intervention for elderly with dementia and then to increase independence of elderly with dementia. There is some picture, some documentation for our research. some elderly and their family, we have to give health education for them. And then for the training and mentoring, we give the elderly and the family door to door. Each family can we can give for training and mentoring. Okay, maybe enough for our presentation. Thank you. Terima kasih. Top Gunha.
Well, thank you, Madam Hidayatus. This a nice presentation, and also this a kind of the experience that your thesis, right? Your okay. Your dissertation.
Okay.
Do yeah. This one. Okay, okay, right. Okay. So we invite the audience to have a question or maybe a comment, and also sharing in Thailand related with the elderly care. I mean that maybe it's a kind of a sharing related with the how to manage the elderly, both in our country. I think it's a best practice in Thailand. Maybe we can share here. Please, maybe if there is a kind of a question or comment in chat box, or click the right hand to directly to the our speaker today. All right. We take a look in the chat box.
All right. First questions. All right. Matut. Yes. Thank you, Hidayatus, for sharing about empowerment for caregiver and enduring elderly with dementia. This is like similar to my research I'm doing for my PhD. Yeah, this is like now is it many countries are like facing this situation as well in Thailand, because the number of elderly people is increasing. That means the number of people with dementia is increasing as well. This is quite important for Thailand to manage and care for people with dementia, in particular people living in community, because elderly with dementia, they are most of them living in the community. Okay, I would like to share about like my experience in research in caring with dementia. Like because in Thailand we don't have like a specific in like the program for people with dementia. They are like we do like with the long term care, like because people with dementia, they have a lot of condition like diabetes, hypertension, like that. We do that together in people with dementia. And then who is a support for people with dementia? Like most of them is a family caregiver in Thailand, because Thailand they living together in the same family. This means the family caregiver is important in caring for people with dementia. How we know about how to support people with dementia in that community? We have a nurse, like social support, and or like a health volunteer, the carer, or like the care manager in that community. They support people with dementia, like they have like a home visit, maybe like every month. As we know, the symptom of dementia seem to fluctuations in every day. This is quite important for the family caregiver to support and know how to support them. This is some example of my experience in caring for people with dementia in the community. Yes. Anyone have any question or sharing about how to care people with dementia in Thailand, or have a question about Hidayatus' presentation? Okay, Dr. Nisakorn, we have a question.
Thank you for your nice presentation. For the second question, I'm curious to know about your intervention, caregiver
empowerment intervention, what is the core components or the key success to promote positive outcome as your result showing, please?
Yes, thank you, Ajanisa Kon. So, Mrs. Hidayatu give a feedback related with the question, Ajanisa Kon.
Okay, thank you. Okay, Achan, thank you very much for your question. Marvelous question. Achan, actually, we give for the family, our respondent, that we teach they for how about ability family to do home care for elderly with dementia. Because elderly with dementia like reasonable for family. And then we teach family to do several interventions, several activities to improve, to support elderly, to support cognitive elderly, like health education, and then trainer, and then mentoring. We give at all, we teach a family how about elderly and dementia, how about a health center or health service program, how about social support that must give that must given by family to elderly with dementia. How about family do some therapy for elderly with dementia, like cognitive therapy, and then that communication therapy, and then recreational therapy, or extra try that we can teach family to give intervention to elderly with dementia. And then we have a model that there consists of some information that how family must to do if the family have elderly with dementia. And then we have we give the family some states. The first is counseling, and the second is a training for the family, and then the third, the last is mentoring. We give we get mentoring for the family, how the family do home care for the elderly with dementia, like that. Achan, thank you.
All right, thank you, Achan Hidayatus. Achan Isakon, is there any feedback again from Achan Isakon? I think, is it okay? Or maybe ready more, maybe you can add this, some comment.
Thank you for your describe about the components of your intervention. It's more clearer and I understand more. Thank you. Anyone for the question?
All right, thank you, Achan Isakon. Okay, please, another audience maybe have something to give a comment to speaker. Well, based on the research study, there is a result that there is the majority, the education of the respondent is a primary degree, right? So
right.
Is there any barrier or a problem doing your intervention? Right.
Okay. Okay.
About it.
Okay. 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 Achan Dwi. Mrs. Dwi, thank you. Okay. It's pandemic and basic background for the family, like is it education for the family, and then income for the family, there is influence our activity for our research, including of this condition for now this is pandemic, we can modify for the family to be give health education. Maybe we give health education, we give health education for each family, and then we get some discuss until we know that the family knows, and then the family can do some or several activities then that our family must do for the elderly with dementia. And then we give mentoring, and then we get evaluation like that we arrange from the module.
Okay. So I think this, it takes time because of the pandemic and also the degree of education,
okay,
right?
Okay.
Yeah. From the chat box, Mrs. Hidayatus, how about to evaluate the indicator of well-being? I mean that after you get the intervention, and then is there any specific result that they have, they already improved their well-being? What do you think?
Okay, okay. Well-being. Okay, thank you for the question. Well-being is one of some indicators in family ability to do home care. Three indicators that about family ability to do home care. The one is perceived health, and the second is perceived goal, and the last is existential well-being. The first one, perceived growth or perceived health. There is how the family know about health and elderly and dementia. And the second indicator is perceived health, perceived growth. This perceived growth that how the family do activity that give the elderly with dementia some therapy that we teach for the elderly according to the module. And then the second is the third is existential well-being. Existential well-being is to the family give extra activity to improve independence for elderly with dementia, like social support from the elderly, and then finance support, and then what is recreational support, and then including for health service activity, health service program that must elderly follow for this activity from health service program like that. And we get to evaluation how existential well-being must be given to the elderly with dementia. We have evaluation according to the module that we know that the family ability family to do home care can do independently for the elderly. Right. Like that. Yes.
So the indicator is they can achieve the competencies based on the targeted the module to detect that they already have a kind of well-being.
Of course, right. Of course.
Okay, thank you. Okay, the next question maybe comment from the audience, please. Maybe directly to the speaker or maybe in the chat box.
I would like just ask some question. This your presentation is very good.
Yes, please.
And I can see how to take care of the patient with dementia, especially in elderly people. I would like to ask you about you have the effective way to improve dementia well-being in elderly, but in many articles indicate that the caregiver feel burdened to take care of the dementia people. I would like to ask you about is happening in your study or not, and what you handle this problem when you teach the caregiver to take care of the dementia people. But when the caregiver asks you about, "I boring to take care of them," how you handle with this situation? Is happening or not? Thank you.
Okay. Okay, thank you, Dr. Shupia.
Thank you, Dr. Shupia. Okay. Actually, family with elderly dementia have what is it? A burden fear. And then some of family for that. We give some motivation to the family that Indonesia have tradition, have social support, high social support for the elderly. In Indonesia, the family plays an important role in treatment strategies and decision making, basic family function and family duties for in health all of the member of the family. And then this is our culture in Indonesia, in Asia actually, especially have some is it value that a couple or some family member of family have duty, have responsibility to do caring to all of the member all of the member of the family, especially elderly with dementia. And then we always give motivation for the family, for the elderly. What is it? This is a support for a program in health service, support for intervention that what is government is it, policies. And we get or we give some result that the family and elderly have good motivation for this, to improve their ability, to improve their independence, to increase their health and their family, like that, Dr. Supia. Okay, okay. Actually, maybe some family, some elderly, that we, they have some what is it, a disease or some problems in their health that we cannot what is it, control for this condition. We can forward to health center or health service to give or to get some intervention, like that, Dr. Supia.
Okay, thank you, Mrs. Hidayatus. Is there any feedback again from Dr. Supia? Maybe is it too long response, I think. Okay, is there any more feedback related with this? Yeah, all right, thank you. Please, we still have a time around 2 minutes more. Is there any more feedback from the audience? I think the dissertation of Mrs. Hidayatus is similar and with the Achana Tawut. Maybe we can have a discussion.
Okay, Achana Tawut, how are you?
Yes, I'm fine. Okay, I would like to share my information about my research. As you know, for my research result, I would like to share that, like in Thailand, we are like a Buddhist, and we follow the social norm. As you know, if some people with dementia in that family, that we know we can't leave our parents alone. Yes, we have to support them. As my advisor asked me that, why you have to support your parents? Why you have to live with your parents like that? Because like in Europe, like in America, this is quite different from our Asia. Yes, they not live together like in Thailand. And then as we know, like we have a filial obligation as like yes, as you said before, you say that's it, our duty, our responsibility to support our parents with dementia. This is quite important from in Thailand as well. As we know, like if that's the main caregiver, like a feel boring, as Ajahn Subbaya asks you, maybe we still have other family caregiver to support if they feel that they feel the burdens in caring for people with dementia. And then because in Thailand community, like in that community, they quite stay together in that community. They can ask other family caregiver to support that. Or they may have like the grandchildren to support as well too. And then some family caregiver say that I can't leave my parents alone. I feel that if I do that, I will be blamed by other people around them like that. And then they feel that's karma if they leave their parents with dementia alone. That's it. I would like to share. Thank you so much.
Yeah, all right. Thank you very much, Ajahn Tawut. I think the is a key point that we have a benefit that our Asia community have the kind of that value that supporting social support and being together in a family to taking care of. It is a potential and also need to maintain that we still taking care of our elderly in us, among us, right? So I think it's a nice sharing today related to the elderly. To sum up the speaker presentation and all discussion, that we need to develop the home care based on empowerment family to increase the quality of life of elderly. So I think it's a extraordinary topic. And then thank you to the audience and also to the speaker, Mrs. Hidayatus. Thank you so much for interactive guest lecture today. After this, move to the Mrs. Sukma. Please continue the next session. Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Mrs. Dwi Priyantini. Thank you, Mrs. Hidayatus, for nice sharing. Make us learn that elderly must be cared and supported by their families, especially elderly with dementia. Thank you to Mrs. Dwi Priyantini as moderator too. And now we come into the happiest moment, this photo session. Please proceed by Mrs. Nuka. Okay, please, everyone, please open your video and keep smile and say cheese.
Okay, I will start for documentation. Start from page one. One, two, three. Okay, and page two.
Yes.
Next three.
Okay, maybe freestyle, like this. Yes, freestyle, maybe. Freestyle, please. Like that.
For the last page. Okay, thank you.
Okay, thank you so much. Finally, we get to the last session in this event, that is closing. Maybe Rima Sarakam have closing speech before we closing that lecture academic acting. Yeah, okay, Dr.
Misa Konfi Bulcai. Yes. All right, before...
No?
All right, before we closing the ceremony, I'm ready to share our screen.
Okay.
And giving certificates for Hirayatas. And...
On behalf of Sri Mahasarakham Nursing College, Faculty of Nursing, Paparumarachanok Institute, Thailand, we are pleased to give Certificate of Appreciation Award to Mrs. Haidayatus Yadiya from Sikes, Hang Tuah, Surabaya, Indonesia. Please give a big hand to her.
Give a clap.
Thank you, Dr. Misa Konfi Bulcai. It's very extraordinary for me. Thank you very much.
Okay.
So far, I'm very proud of ongoing academic collaboration. Firstly, I would like to thank you all, the speaker, for their excellent thought-provoking talks and the participants for patiently listening. Without you, this exchange would not have been the success it has. It's not surprising that the topic on caregiver empowerment for elderly with dementia and simulation-based learning, just like the reality in our webinar rooms, ticker many bells with me and many other participants. We can summarize this by saying that family caregiver of elderly with dementia experience significant physical, psychological, and social burden that need to empowerment. As we know, empowerment refers to the process of gaining power as society in society through behavioral change for coping successfully with care-related burden. Beyond this, the presentation provides a cultural perspective of elderly care and contributes to building a more true understanding of empowerment among family caregivers in Indonesia. We can realize that what are similar caring in Asian country and what difference from Western society. In the other aspect of presentation today is about teaching method. We cannot deny that currently simulation-based learning has opened up a new educational application in nursing and other disciplines. It is a technique, not technology, to replace and amplify real experiences with guide ones. Simulation-based learning can be the answer to developing health professionals' knowledge, skills, and attitudes while protecting patients from unnecessary risks. The key to success in simulation training is integrating it into traditional education
programs, teamworks, trainings conducted in the simulated environment may also offer an additive benefit to the traditional didactic instruction, enhance performance, and possibly also reduce errors. The cost effectiveness of potentially expensive simulation-based medical or nursing education and training should be examined in terms of improvement of clinical competence and its impact on patient safety. Perhaps with the adoption of simulation as the standard of training and certification, healthcare system will be viewed as more accountable and ethical by the population they serve. I feel, along with many others here, that this exchange is very useful and to continue. So the future looks very bright. I firmly believe that STIKET Hang Tuah Surabaya, Indonesia will remain our most important partner, co-worker, and family. Finally, I would like to thank Ajahn Dewi, Dr. Nutterwood, for their excellent collaboration to make this exchange a success. Thank you very much. I wish you all a blessed day.
Thank you. My pleasure, Ajahn Isakon.
Okay, thank you so much, Dr. Misakon, for your speech. Okay, and ladies and gentlemen, don't forget to fill the attendance form. And finally, we get to the last session in this event that is closing. Let's close this event by saying Alhamdulillah. Alhamdulillah, Hirobil Alamin.
Alhamdulillah, Hirobil Alamin. Give applause.
Okay, give applause for us. Okay. This is the end of the session of Academic Exchange 2022. Thanks to the speaker, committee, and the audience that had participated actively. Hope to see you again next time in the future. Goodbye. Sawadika.
Sawadika. Thank you, Ajahn Isakon. Thank you to all the big family of Sri Masarakam Nursing College.
Thank you as well.
Yeah.
Have a good day. Bye. Bye for
bye
now.
Bye. Thank you. See you.
Thank you, Ajahn. ประชุม
นะครับก็ขอขอบคุณอาจารย์ทุกท่านนะครับที่เข้าร่วม
Thailand Organizing Committee and participants who have made the student exchange 2021 possible. And at fun, we will arrange to lecture
and students of STIKET Hang Tuah Surabaya and Sri Masarakam Nursing College.
Discuss about three topics. The first topic is perception of society about crazy nation. The second is price of crazy nation in Indonesia and in Taiwan. And the last topic is the first topic.
Oh.
development of muscle relaxation on development for vegetable farming. This innovation in the first place in the
COVID-19 vaccine. The first is on the list of vaccines that have been approved by the World Health Organization or WHO. Second, the availability of vaccines. And third, permission from the Food and Drug Supervisory Agency. Sinovac, that's the first vaccine that
even though in virtual. Hopefully that in the future we can do the exchange by visit to Sri Masyarakat Nursing College, and also Sri Masyarakat will be come to Surabaya. See you in the next session.
Oke, Monikin, rekan-rekan dosen dan mahasiswa, apabila ada acara, kami persilakan untuk keluar dari ruang Zoom. Acara akan kami lanjutkan dengan video profil dan akan kami close. Terima kasih telah berpartisipasi dalam acara guest lecture pada hari ini. Wassalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Surabaya adalah ibu kota Provinsi Jawa Timur, sekaligus kota metropolitan terbesar kedua di Indonesia. Surabaya juga merupakan salah satu kota tujuan pendidikan, khususnya pendidikan tenaga kesehatan di Indonesia yang sangat diperhitungkan. Ribuan siswa maupun mahasiswa dari berbagai daerah di Indonesia mengenyam pendidikan di kota ini. Salah satu pilar penyangga pendidikan tinggi kesehatan di kota Surabaya adalah Stikes Hang Tuah Surabaya. Selamat datang di kampus Sekolah Tinggi Ilmu Kesehatan Hang Tuah Surabaya. Stikes Hang Tuah Surabaya di bawah naungan Yayasan NALA, yaitu salah satu yayasan yang dimiliki oleh TNI Angkatan Laut sehingga kampus kami berada dalam satu lokasi dengan Rumah Sakit Pusat Angkatan Laut Dr. Ramelan Surabaya, yaitu di Jalan Gadung nomor 1 Surabaya. Stika Santua Surabaya hadir untuk memenuhi kebutuhan tenaga kesehatan di rumah sakit, klinik kesehatan, puskesmas, maupun tempat pelayanan kesehatan lain, baik yang berafiliasi dengan TNI Angkatan Laut, pemerintah, maupun fasilitas pelayanan kesehatan swasta, serta memberi kesempatan pada putra-putri anggota TNI, khususnya TNI Angkatan Laut, serta keluarganya untuk meningkatkan jenjang pendidikan tinggi, dan juga memberi kesempatan kepada putra-putri terbaik bangsa Indonesia untuk menjadi tenaga kesehatan profesional yang memiliki kompetensi, berbudi pekerti luhur, tangguh, sehat, cerdas, patriotik, berdisiplin, kreatif, produktif, dan profesional. Stika Santua Surabaya lahir diawali dengan adanya kerjasama antara Yayasan Nala dengan Rumkital Dr. Ramelan Surabaya dalam mendirikan Akper Hang Tuah Surabaya pada tanggal 7 Juni 1995. Pada pertengahan 2005, dimulailah usaha-usaha untuk merintis perubahan bentuk Akademi Keperawatan menjadi Sekolah Tinggi Ilmu Kesehatan. Dan pada tahun 2006, Sekolah Tinggi Ilmu Kesehatan Hang Tuah Surabaya resmi berdiri.
Sekolah Tinggi Ilmu Kesehatan Hang Tuah Surabaya memiliki visi menjadi sekolah tinggi ilmu kesehatan yang profesional dan kompetitif di bidang kesehatan, kemaritiman, dan kelautan yang berbasis perkembangan iptek kesehatan pada tahun 2035. Untuk mewujudkan visi tersebut, Stikes Hang Tuah Surabaya menyusun misi, yaitu pertama, menyelenggarakan pendidikan dan pembelajaran secara profesional dan kompetitif di bidang kesehatan, kemaritiman, dan kelautan yang berbasis perkembangan iptek kesehatan. Kedua, menyelenggarakan penelitian dan publikasi ilmiah secara profesional dan kompetitif di bidang kesehatan, kemaritiman, dan kelautan yang berbasis perkembangan iptek kesehatan. Ketiga, menyelenggarakan pengabdian kepada masyarakat secara profesional dan kompetitif di bidang kesehatan, kemaritiman, dan kelautan yang berbasis perkembangan iptek kesehatan. Keempat, menyelenggarakan tata kelola kelembagaan secara profesional dan kompetitif di bidang kesehatan, kemaritiman, dan kelautan yang berbasis perkembangan iptek kesehatan. Kami menerapkan tata nilai di lingkungan Stikes Hang Tuah Surabaya yang mendasari sikap dan perilaku seluruh sivitas akademika. Tata nilai yang kami laksanakan adalah cerdas. Cerdas merupakan singkatan dari nilai-nilai luhur yang kami yakini, yaitu caring, excellent, respectful, disiplin, altruistik, dan smart.
Stika Hang Tuah Surabaya telah memiliki 5 program studi, yaitu D3 Keperawatan, S1 Keperawatan, Prodi Pendidikan Profesi Nurse, S1 Gizi, dan D4 Manajemen Informasi Kesehatan. Program Studi Keperawatan adalah program studi unggulan di Stikes Hang Tuah Surabaya. Kami selalu mencetak tenaga keperawatan medis yang unggul dan siap bersaing di dunia kerja. Prodi ini dibagi menjadi 2, yaitu Prodi Keperawatan S1 dan D3. Alumni Diploma 3 Keperawatan berperan sebagai perawat terampil dalam menyelesaikan masalah keperawatan secara mandiri dan berkelompok yang direncanakan sesuai dengan standar asuhan keperawatan dengan kemampuan menerima tanggung jawab terhadap keputusan dan tindakan asuhan keperawatan profesional sesuai dengan lingkup praktik dan hukum dan peraturan perundangan. Prodi S1 Ilmu Keperawatan menyelenggarakan pendidikan akademik untuk menghasilkan sarjana keperawatan dengan gelar S.Kep.
yang nantinya berpeluang untuk melanjutkan pendidikan ke jenjang profesi nurse ataupun jenjang magister sesuai dengan minat masing-masing. Prodi Pendidikan Profesi Nurse merupakan perawat profesional yang cerdas dan kompeten dalam memberikan asuhan keperawatan kepada klien dan mampu melakukan fungsi manajemen keperawatan. Prodi S1 Gizi mencetak lulusan yang dapat menjadi pengambil keputusan dalam memecahkan permasalahan gizi, baik program dan kebijakan gizi, komunitas maupun sosial secara profesional dan bertanggung jawab. Prodi D4 Manajemen Informasi Kesehatan mencetak lulusan yang kompeten dalam mengumpulkan, mengintegrasikan, dan menganalisa data rekam medis serta data pendukung lainnya untuk kepentingan perawatan pasien yang efektif serta kepentingan lain seperti penelitian, pendidikan, perencanaan, dan evaluasi pelayanan kesehatan. Sarana pembelajaran yang lengkap sangat diperlukan untuk menunjang efektivitas pembelajaran offline guna meningkatkan kompetensi mahasiswa. Sarana yang terdapat di Stikes Hang Tuah, Surabaya adalah Lab Keperawatan Dasar, Keperawatan Medikal Bedah dan Gawat Darurat, Lab Keperawatan Maternitas dan Anak, Lab Jiwa, Komunitas dan Keluarga, Jiwa dan Gerontik, Laboratorium Biomedik, Anatomi dan Ruang Tutorial, Lab Skill yang terdiri dari 2 lantai untuk meningkatkan skill prosedur, Lab Komputer, Perpustakaan terdiri dari ruang baca, ruang internet, dan ruang pelayanan. Selain itu, untuk mendukung pembelajaran daring, tersedia berbagai macam video pembelajaran di website dan YouTube. Indonesia sebagai negara maritim terbesar dunia memiliki sejumlah wilayah laut, pesisir, dan pulau-pulau kecil yang luas dan bermakna strategis dalam pembangunan ekonomi nasional. Stikes Hang Tuah Surabaya dalam peranannya di bidang pendidikan kesehatan memberikan wawasan kesehatan maritim dan kelautan di dalam kurikulum pendidikannya dalam bentuk materi kuliah matra kesehatan laut dan udara serta dibentuknya UKM atau unit kegiatan mahasiswa Kesmala.